checking my vitals on drum. My battle lines going to war again. Feeling the rhythm inside of my chest. All I need is just a pen. I know I was born for this. I know I was born for this. Don't care for the critics. My words and my physics are force that they can't stop. They just don't get it. I think they forget I'm not done till I'm
well, welcome everyone to this week's episode. This is number 8 of your podcast, and we're coming to you directly from the Bamboo Lab. I'm Brian Bolsey, Peak Performance Coach, and for the past 25 years, I've been working with people just like you. I've had the greatest of pleasures over the past quarter century working with thousands of strivers, thrivers, and survivors just like you. You know, and I've said this every session so far, and every episode, but this is for you out there who feel maybe you're just underachieving a little bit in life. You know, maybe you just know, hey, I've got a lot more to offer. I've got a lot more to give to myself, to my loved ones, and to the world at large. Or maybe you feel like you're stuck on that hamster wheel. You know, you're just kind of spinning and you're spinning and you just want to get off. You want to break free, get off, and plow forward in life. If that describes you at all, you landed in the right spot. This is for you. This is your Bamboo Lab. Today, I want to take a few moments to thank three listeners that we pulled out of our recent communication. And one of them is Mark P. out of Howell, Michigan, and sometimes from Pinehurst, North Carolina. Thanks, Mark. Era F. from Ontario, Canada, coming across the border. And David L. from, I believe, Warner Robins, Georgia. Anyway, thank you, all three of you, and welcome. It's a pleasure to have you. I'd like to read one letter that we got recently, and as you know, one of my goals and expectations, actually, is that to collect at least 10,000 hearts, we call them, and 10,000 correspondence from individuals just like you, people who have listened to the podcast and gotten some value out of it. Please share with me via text, email, or snail mail, or whoever you want. Just, hey, this is what I've got out of it. It could be something small, some small minor change that you made, or something you learned that clicked for you. I'd love to hear it. I would love to. This one comes, and I'll read it out to you directly. It says, "And thank you. I'd like to." This came at an actual perfect time, Brian. I had an executive recruiter reach out to me about a director position at a hotel and resort. I was hesitant because I'm not familiar with the casinos. But I emailed him my updated resume, and I told him I was interested. Now he's going to call me tonight so we can discuss further. Sometimes to find your butter, you have to step out of your comfort zone and believe in yourself and your ability. I love that. Gives me goosebumps. Well, I got to tell you, I believe in your ability, all of you. I believe in your skill set, your ability. The question is all about desire now. You know, I want to take a moment here to honor and dedicate this particular episode, number 8 here, to an amazing, amazing person. Probably one of the strongest people I've ever met in my life. And I've had the pleasure of her being in my life since the day I was born. My sister, Jeannie. You know, some of you who follow me on social media have seen Jeannie, know Jeannie. We have a kind of a little battle going back and forth to see who's the funniest one in the family, but she doesn't stand a chance. But she puts up a good battle, just like she did in January of 2008 when she was diagnosed with colorectal cancer. Devastating news for her and for the entire family. But she stood up. She fought it. She kicked its ass and became cancer-free. But, you know, sometimes the universe has a way of testing people. And when it sees a strong person out there, it might throw a little extra jab at you. And it did. 3 years later, January of 2011, she was diagnosed with kidney cancer. A 1-2 punch. You know, a lot of people would have just given up, sat down, pouted, full of self-pity. She didn't do that. She stood up again. She fought harder than she did the first time. She fought with more confidence and strength. And again, she kicked its ass. Today, as we sit here, March 7th of 2022, Jeannie is cancer-free. Stronger than ever. More inspiring than ever. The one beautiful thing about my sister is during all of that, in fact, during my entire life, she always wore that infectious smile, and she still does to this day. Thank you, sister, for inspiring me, for inspiring the world. I love you. The last few episodes, the last two episodes, actually, we've been talking about fears. You know, we talked, I think, 3 weeks ago about choosing your pain in life. You know, you can choose that pain of hard work and just grit and getting dirty and bloody and muddy and torn up. Or you can choose the pain of regret. Only two choices. And how often we choose that pain of regret is because we have fears. Damn, we've got a lot of fears. I mean, I Googled phobias the other day. I couldn't count how many phobias there are. Afraid of dogs, snakes, heights, small spaces, being alone, being with a bunch of people. You know, there's just a lot of them. And I've got some myself. There's no doubt about that. You know, I've often read that when we are born as babies, we are afraid of two things. Fear of falling and fear of loud noises. You know, you go behind a baby and make a loud noise, it'll jump. If you're ever holding a baby and you kind of stumble, the baby stiffens up. Those are innate fears. Just about every other fear we have is culturized into us. It's taught us. And most of them are not really rational. Studies show that babies really don't show any signs of fear until roughly between the ages of 8 and 12, which is right in the sweet spot from where my little pal Jack, my grandson, is right now. And oftentimes those fears are, they manifest in us simply because the baby was maybe put in the arms of a stranger. Or maybe they actually watch their parents show fear towards something, so they mimic that fear. Again, it's culturized. It's given to us. Let's dissect. Last week, I had a very special guest on here. And it was probably, you know, of the seven episodes up until that point, the seven episodes, that was my favorite one. I had Dawson Bosley, my son, on here, 19-year-old freshman at Northern Michigan University. And because of his experience with karate and as from 12 years or from 8, then becoming a black belt 12, and now going into the boxing ring over the past couple of years and doing more of the sweet sport of boxing, we talked about the fears and how they manifest themselves in us. And he made an incredible point that I've thought about, and it's I've internalized, and it's kind of haunted me these past 7 days. He said, you know, when you go into the ring, you know, we have these primal fears of flight or fight in life. And he said, when you step into a ring or on a mat, there is no flight option. Nobody backs out and steps over the ropes and goes back out of the ring or steps off the mat and says, no mas, I'm done, no fight here. That's true. What if we could take that same idea and plant it in our own lives on a day-to-day basis? Flight is not an option. Fleeing is not an option. So think about those opportunities you may have been thinking about recently that you want to take advantage of, some things you want to build, create, do. Maybe you want to ask someone out. Maybe you've been looking at starting a business or a side hustle. Maybe going on that diet. You know, booking that vacation or that trip, whatever it is, if there's something holding you back and the thing you are trying to do is the right thing for you in your life, screw it. Take the flight option right out of off the table and move forward. It taught me a lot last week. So thank you, son. I appreciate that. So last week we introduced you to the two major types of fear, fear of failure and fear of success. You know, and fear of failure, as I mentioned last week, is really it's really made up of three other fears. And those three fears are fear of rejection, fear of being embarrassed, in fear of losing what you already have. So I'm here to tell you, we all have fear of failure. Because there ain't nobody on this call who wants to be rejected, embarrassed, or lose what they have, including me. On Saturday, we had an ice storm up here in the upper part of Michigan, and I got out of the vehicle, was walking into the post office, and on the sidewalk, it was glare ice. I wasn't aware of it. I slipped and fell right on my ass. You know, it hurt. I hurt my wrist a little bit, but not major. But the first thing that I thought of right away was, oh, man, who saw that? I was more embarrassed about maybe somebody saw me fall than I was about my own bodily harm. We don't want to be embarrassed. We don't want to be rejected in life by others, and we certainly in hell don't want to lose what we have. So we all have that fear. But the beauty of fear of failure is if you fear something, you innately move away from it. I'm afraid of bats, so I don't go in buildings that are filled with bats. I'm afraid of some heights, so I don't climb buildings. So I stay away from those. So if you fear failure, you are naturally going to walk and progress away from failure and therefore towards success. So you wonder, if we all have this fear of failure, why are we all highly successful? And just to share with you, when I talk about success, I don't just mean professional or monetary success. I also mean happiness, great health, love, peace, whatever you're striving for in life. If the opposite of that fears you and you innately go away from what you fear, why don't we all have and live right now at the peak of our level in success? Because all of us are driving with our emergency brake on. Because what we have done is we have failed to really consider that other fear, and that's fear of success. If you have a fear of what you're striving for in life, can you see how that could subconsciously hold you back? Now, I've been coaching successful people, strivers, thrivers, and survivors for 25 plus years now. And I can share with you, the majority of them had fear of success in them and didn't even know it. And you do too. So what I want you to do today is, when I go through some of these reasons why we might fear success, jot down the one that you think represents you. One that you think, wow, I sometimes feel that way. Or that could be me. Put it down. Because what we want to do is kind of expose the reasons. And if we can just say, this is the reason why I might fear success, then now you can start working on that. Because you've admitted it, you've exposed it. And as we've talked about in the last couple of sessions, exposure to problems, exposures to fears, to phobias is the greatest first step you can take. In fact, sometimes that's the only step necessary to take, is expose the damn thing. Expose the monster on the screen and the monster is no longer powerful. It loses its impact, its authority over you. So last week I gave you a couple of reasons why we might fear success. And I'll just summarize those very quickly, and I'll jump on to the rest of them. One reason we might fear success is because we live in a world right now where we like to topple icons. Icon toppling is one of the reasons we fear success. We watch our society tear people apart who have become successful. Get too big for your britches? We'll tear you down. This baloney process of cancel culture in the past few years in our country has made this problem even worse. And in my opinion, it's going to hinder a lot of people subconsciously from reaching their peak in life. It's not just for celebrities and politicians and athletes. It's for everybody. We see that. And it subconsciously pulls us away from really wanting to reach the peak of our level in life because somebody might cancel us. So we stay away from the highest levels of love, success, you know, peace, great health, and all those other areas, those things we're striving for. So that's one of them. Another one is something we call the imposter syndrome. And that is, a lot of people feel like once they reach success in life that they're really, it's not them. They're an imposter. They're fraudulent. And they fear that, they feel like, I'm becoming more and more successful. I'm more and more happy, healthy. I'm in love. Whoa. That's not me. They feel like they're standing in the wrong line and somebody's going to come over and tap them on the shoulder and say, hey, sorry, man. We put you in the wrong line. You have to get over here. You're in the line of failures. So we're always kind of, we're always looking, you know, over our shoulders and keeping our head on a swivel, making sure that, you know, in fear that we're in fact fraudulent if we become healthy, happy, full of love, or successful. But there are other reasons why we might fear success. So like I said, give yourself a good audit today and ask yourself, is this a potential fear for me? Another one is being under a microscope. And this one really does relate a lot to the icon toppling. Because, you know, once you are successful, people start to watch you. They really do. They start to look at you. They start to dissect you. They start to judge you. They start to, and sometimes it's good stuff. Sometimes they look at you as a role model and they want to follow you. And some people are uncomfortable with that. You know, mediocrity is a great camouflage. And sometimes we like to kind of be that wallflower that sits in the back of the room and doesn't say too much. Expectations will increase. And that can cause some stress. But one thing I learned a long time ago is, you know, where you're really around the most people judging you is not when you're successful. It's when you're mediocre, because the vast majority of people are mediocre. Sorry to say it. I'm not judging. I'm just stating a fact. You know, we play in this role where everybody wants to be so similar to each other, and we're so afraid to branch out. And we're afraid if we branch out, more people are going to be looking at you, and they will be. But right now, a ton of people are looking at you right now as well. And I'll share with you, if you branch out and become that true version of yourself and hit that true peak capacity that you can live in all those areas we've talked about, love, happiness, peace, success, great health, I tell you, it's never crowded along the extra mile. That's where you get your most serenity. So that's one reason, though. I'm going to be under a microscope if I become successful. But like I said, you're under one now. Just the wrong microscope. Another reason we might fear success is we feel that if we become successful or change ourselves and become a better version of ourselves, we have to change our friends. Yeah, there's some truth to that. There really is. But it doesn't mean you have to give up on the friends you have or the family you have right now at all. It doesn't mean that. But we do become an average of the people we hang out with most in our world. And sometimes people feel that they're extremely successful in life and they are the king of their little realm in life. But in reality, they're the king of the dipshits. Do you want to be the king of the dipshits? Probably not. So it doesn't mean you have to give up on friends. It's just making sure that the people you are associated with most are there to support you, challenge you, and celebrate with you. They want to see you grow. They want to grow with you. And they want you to help them grow. So sometimes if you feel like maybe the group you're with doesn't do that, don't get rid of them necessarily, unless they're extremely unhealthy for you. Just find the ones in that group that do that for you and spend more time with them. And go outside and bring in more people into your group, into your board of directors, so to speak, into your pack that are the kind of people you want to associate with. Another reason we might fear success is, and this is a big one, this has a lot to do with, it's very synonymous with the imposter syndrome or even icon toppling to some degree, and that is if we are successful, we don't feel we deserve it. We feel like, and it is a little bit different than the imposter syndrome, where that one is you don't feel like you truly are successful or you don't belong there. This one is more innate. It's more about your self-esteem and your confidence and your sense of self-worth, where you feel like, I don't deserve this at all. What have I done to become successful, to become happy? How do I deserve the love that this person gives me every day? I mean, how many relationships have been dissolved because one person loved the other one so much that that person receiving that love did not feel that they were worthy of the love they received? It happens all the time. You know, if you don't have a favorable impression of yourself, then how can you really believe that you deserve the best that life has to offer? I mean, I think it was Ralph Waldo Emerson that said, self-trust is the first secret to success. You've got to trust yourself. You've got to feel you deserve it. So I'm going to give you a task right now, or an idea challenge. And I gave this one, I think, on the second episode as well, is when you're done today, get up, go find that box or that photo album you have. It might be a little weathered. Maybe you have pictures stored on your phone or your computer. But then when you do that, find a picture of yourself as a young child. As a young child, maybe 2, 3, 4, 5 years old. Now, pretend this child is not you for a moment. It's just another boy or girl that you love dearly. That's your entire world. And tell this young person how worthy they are. Tell them they are destined for greatness. Inspire them, motivate them, you know, advise them. Study the face of that child, the eyes. Notice the way she or he is standing and what they're doing in the photo. Note that innocence and that beauty. Can you honestly look that child in the eye and say, he or she doesn't deserve the best that life has to offer? The most fulfilling relationships, the most exciting careers, the most endearing love? Honestly, tell me that child does not deserve success. You can't. Because you know that child deserves success. The best, the greatest that life has to offer him or her. Don't take that picture and go to the bathroom or your bedroom and look in the mirror and say those same encouraging words to yourself. And for a lot of you, it might be the first time you've ever done that. Because you deserve the best. And that child is just you. Do you feel that that child could look at you 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90 years later? Are they proud of the person they've grown into? Can they say, I've grown into a person who truly lives at his or her peak capacity? Someone who is at their highest level in love and health and success and peace and happiness. Carry that picture around. Whenever you doubt yourself, look at that picture again. And ask yourself, what could you do at that moment to make that little child, that young boy or girl, proud of the person you are right now at this moment? So if you don't feel like you deserve it, I'm here to tell you, you do. Because that little boy and that little girl that still resides in you certainly does. Another reason we might fear success is we're just not used to it. You know, so often, you know, we get maybe a big bonus check at work, or we fall in love to a level we've never been there before. And it's awkward. It's brand new. It's completely foreign to us. You know, we've talked about a few sessions ago about the comfort zone. When we have these new levels of success, man, we're out of our comfort zone. Our resistance bands are stretched so wide that they're starting to get white and frail, and they're going to bend or they're going to break if we don't snap back. When we feel that we're unaccustomed to something like that, that's a time we have to stretch that comfort zone even further. If it's money that you feel like you're unaccustomed to, make more money. If it's that love that you feel you're unaccustomed to, love even deeply, more deeply. If it's happiness, do things that make yourself even happier. If it's health that you feel unaccustomed to, that great health you've been feeling, go out and work out a little harder, eat a little better, even more so. Stretch that resistance band until that what you are unaccustomed to becomes evident to you, self-evident. Now you are fully accustomed to that new higher level of yourself. Another reason we might fear success is because we don't want to become more successful than our parents. You know, I don't see this one as often, you know, because most of the time our parents have told us, you know, we want you to grow to be a better version of ourselves. We want you to take your life to a higher level. A friend of mine in Grand Rapids, Michigan, used to always say, and this goes out to Jeff, a quote that always stuck with me. He said, our job is, we're like fish. Our job is to push our children further up the river, further up the stream. But sometimes we had a very dominating parent that made us always feel like we were less than. If that's the case, realize they messed up. Doesn't mean you have to pay the price. Their job was always to push us further up the stream. And if you have children, you can't push them further up the stream until you push yourself further up the stream than your parents did. That's called progress. And it's what we are as humans, as an animal, we are designed to do that for our species. As we go down the list, another reason we might fear success is because we feel like it's going to be a little more responsibility and take a little more time. You know, I'm already overloaded. I do enough already. I don't want to devote my entire life to becoming more successful. What about this work-life balance thing, Brian? I hear these questions all the time. And here's the deal. I have news for you. You don't need to do more. You just need to do different. I mean, success is no harder to reach than failure is. In fact, I think sometimes it's simpler. But you have to give yourself a good objective audit and reevaluate how do you currently spend your time, your energy, and your focus. Because I do believe that we choose, talking simply about income and money. I believe we choose the money we make. I firmly believe that. We have chosen the amount of money we make in life. And if you feel like you don't have a lot of time, I'm here to tell you, you do. You have time to work almost 2 full-time jobs if you just do one simple thing. Smash your remote control and stop watching television. Holy shit, Brian, what are you talking about? That's how I come down from a long, stressful day. TV doesn't de-stress you. I mean, come on. TV just makes you more stressed. Look at the news, CNN, Fox, MSNBC, ABC, CBS, MSNBC. Those things, all they do is make you more stressed. It's all bad news. TV shows don't make us de-stress. They're just entertaining. And I read a great quote the other day from the 5 a.m. Club, the book, The 5 a.m. Club. It said, victims love entertainment. Victors love education. Average American spends between 21.7 to 31.5 hours a week watching television. But I don't have enough time. We're going to talk about this in a further episode and talking about really what watching television costs you on an annual basis. And I'm here to tell you, I'll give you a little head start on this one. For the average American in our country, TV costs $40,057 a year. $40,057 a year is what it costs the average American to watch television at the rate he or she watches it. We'll come back to that in the future. Another reason we might fear success, and this is a big one I see, is that we sometimes see life as a zero-sum game. If I win, somebody else has to lose. You know, this limited pie kind of theory. But Dr. Stephen Covey, in his revolutionary book, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, he said it best. He said, most people are deeply scripted in what I call the scarcity mentality. They see life as having only so much, as though there is only one pie out there. And if someone gets a bigger piece of the pie, it means I get less and everybody else gets less. The scarcity mentality is a zero-sum paradigm of life. He said the true reality is that life is abundance mentality, which flows out of a deeper sense of personal worth and security. It is the paradigm that there is plenty out there and enough to spare for everybody. It results in sharing of prestige, of recognition, of profits, of decision-making. It opens up possibilities, options, alternatives, and creativity. So when we think if I win, somebody loses, or if somebody else wins, I lose, that's a scarcity mentality. When in reality, the realities of life say, if I win and I create something and I do better, I inspire others to do the same thing. That's abundance mentality. That's reality. And the last reason that some people fear success, and I don't see this as often, but I do sometimes see this with people who have a desire for a strong adrenaline rush. Or they're just so used to always putting out fires in life that they see maybe success is too routine for them. Now, they don't consciously think of this or say it out loud, but they sometimes will think that. And they like the fact that they can crash and burn a bit so they can pick themselves up because they get that rush out of that. But really, when you really dissect that one, it's really a combination of a multitude of the other reasons that I've mentioned already. Don't think you believe, or you don't think you're worthy of success, so you crash and burn. You might think you're an imposter when you're successful, so you crash and burn. But they kind of use this idea that subconscious that it's too routine for them. They like to be able to, you know, pick themselves up quite often. Man, I call it what it is. It's okay to pick yourself up. It's just not okay to force yourself to fall. One is nature. When you fall naturally, it's one thing. When you fall on purpose, it's insanity. And insanity is a horrible strategy to follow in life. So think about these, you know, these fear of failure, fear of success. One is one we all have, you know, fear of failure. But it's okay, because if we fear something, we're going to go naturally away from it. So therefore, if you fear failure, you're going to walk away from it and you're going to become successful in whatever category that means for you. But what if you fear success? That thing you're going toward, man, it's mind-boggling. It kind of makes you, it makes you go batshit crazy. I'm afraid of this, so I go toward this, but I'm actually afraid of this, but I don't want to admit it. I really don't, I'm not even aware that I'm afraid of this. I mean, just sit down and realize there's a very, very, very good chance that you fear success. You fear happiness. You fear great health. You fear love, and you fear peace. And then ask yourself, go back through this podcast again. Pull a friend or a family member and listen to it together and say, hey, which one of these do you think I fear? Which one of these do I exhibit based on what you know? And then also give yourself a good audit and say, which is the most probable one of these? I'm going to leave you with a little piece I wrote today because I really wanted to share this. I posted on some of my social media sites today, and it fits in so well with this fear. And because to me, to overcome any type of fear, it takes heroism. You know, my sister Jeannie exemplifies heroism. So I'm going to read this to you, and then we're going to wrap it up from here. Each of us at one point or another in our childhood dreams of being a hero, of donning the cape and that cape and that mask, of rushing toward things while others are fleeing away from them, of saving lives and destroying the oppressor, of being revered by the masses. And I remember as a kid, you know, running through the house with a towel around my neck, safety pin. You know, I was going to be Superman or the Flash or Batman or whoever. Then at some point, something happens. Some say that reality sinks in. Others claim we simply mature and outgrow these naive dreams. We go to school, we find a job, we get married, we have kids, we retire, we die. Never having leapt a tall building, not even one time. After all, it's pretty tough being a hero, spending your days in a cubicle or raising a family, right? Bullshit. Heroism doesn't require some death-defying action or grandiose response. We don't have to have a secret identity or a hidden lair like Batman. There's only really one requirement: a decision to be. Each of us is presented with opportunities throughout the day to make or to not make this decision. Those opportunities might be subtle, they might be quiet, but they're there right in front of us. So go back to those days when heroism seemed within your grasp, when you were certain that you would someday save the world. Brush off all those decades of self-doubt, of being average, of all that fear. In other words, find that S that you once wore so proudly on your chest. Peace and prosperity to all of you tonight. Again, thank you for joining me. I'm so honored to be here each Monday afternoon and evening with you. And, you know, go out there this week. Live authentically. You know, brush away those fears. Move forward. Take Dawson Bosley's advice. Take flight right off the table. Fleeing is not an option this week. And next week when we talk, I think you'll be a better person. God bless all of you. God bless your families. God bless your friends. And by all means, God bless your dreams. I was born for this, I know.